let me, I have to make it clear so that the word said feet, not foot. Both legs were paralyzed. He couldn't walk. Sometimes a one-legged person can use a crutch and walk, but this guy couldn't walk. He had to be lifted up and carried daily. He was a burden to somebody else. Somebody had to carry him every day. I don't want to make the application, but I feel led of the Lord right now to introduce the subject to you, is that do people have to carry you? Are you lame in your feet? Now, spiritually speaking, we walk by faith. Spiritual man has to walk by faith. And when the spiritual man's legs are paralyzed and he cannot walk, somebody has to carry him. And you will always be asking people to say a prayer for me. Bring me before God. Help me. I am paralyzed, you are saying, but you don't acknowledge it because you're lame spiritually in your feet. You can't walk by faith. You can't walk alone. Somebody have to carry you. Somebody have to talk to you. Somebody have to encourage you. All the time, every day, you get discouraged every morning. You are oppressed, depressed, and your spirit is compressed. There is no liberty in your life. You are a broken person. You are wounded from a long time. Your legs are crooked. The physician, Luke, describes it in medical terms. The ankle bones receive strength. My subject. Wait at the gate. My theme, he will make everything straight. If you wait at this gate, whatever is crooked in your life, whatever is crooked in your body, whatever is crooked in your past or present, if you wait at this gate, God will make everything straight. Say straight. And some of you are going to walk out here leaping and rejoicing because God is going to touch you from his word and through his word. Amen. Before I come to Gate Beautiful, there are three gates. I want to mention them briefly and show you a beautiful truth, if you would allow me to get into your mind and show you this revelation and think deeply as I talk about it. Judges chapter 16, verse 1 to 3. Now Samson went to Gaza and saw a harlot there and went in unto her. When the Gazites were told Samson has come here, they surrounded the place and lay in wait for him all night at the gate of the city. They were quiet all night, saying, in the morning when it's daylight, we will kill him. The enemy surrounds the gate. Okay, get that. The enemy is at the gate. There are some of you who are waiting at this gate. And you're surrounded by the enemy. And Samson lay till midnight. Then he arose at midnight, took hold of the doors of the gate of the city and the two gate posts and pulled them up, bar and all, put them on his shoulder and carried them to the top of the hill that faces Hebron. Here is what happened. He had sinned all the time with a harlot. And as soon as it finished at midnight, he just took up this big giant gate, put it on his shoulders, rooted it out, plucked it out in the face of the enemy, and carried it up a hill. Now, forget the sin of Samson. I want to show you how beautiful a typology that is in the life of Jesus Christ. I want to show you the strength of Jesus. When he went into Gethsemane, there he became sin. for us who knew no sin. God imputed our sins upon him as if to say that the sins of the world were on his back. But there in the garden, Jesus, in the sin upon him, taking it up to Calvary, up a hill, he rooted out the gates of hell, put it on his shoulder, even when the sins of the world were upon him, put it on his shoulder, the posts and the bars, and he walked up with the gates of hell unto the top, and there openly he forever shut the gates of hell to them who would believe on him. You don't have to go to hell because there is not a way of escape. Jesus died so you don't have to go to hell. He said the gates of hell will no longer prevail against my church because he rooted up the gates. And he broke it and he said, beyond that, I also have the keys. So we have a good start with the gate because Jesus uprooted, put it on his shoulders, took it up there, even when the sins of the world was already upon him. In his weakest moment, he destroyed the strongest fortification of hell. What a savior. Can I hear an amen? Amen. So sometimes you might be fooling around. The enemy is at the gate waiting for you for the morning. Stop fooling around. You may not have the strength to break that gate, and the enemy might catch you. The second gate, I'm just because I'm talking about gates. If you wait to the gate, there are many gates, but I'm just picking these two and then come to gate beautiful. The gate, 2 Samuel 18, 24. Many of you are this gate. This is the gate of sad news and bad news. Unfortunately, I cannot tell you that good news will come to you every day. Oh yes, we have paramountly great news, the gospel, Jesus is always good news. But the reality of life is you may get some bad news. And David was sitting between the two gates. These were the royal gates. His son, Absalom, had revolted against him. There was a warrant out to kill the son. Abner and Joab will be merciless. And David begged them, please don't kill my boy. And so the armies went out searching for Absalom. And David was now sitting between two gates. And the watchmen went up onto the roof over the gate. They had a little cottage-like where they would sleep at night and watch on the wall. He lifted up his eyes and looked, and there was a man running alone. And so the first runner came, and David said, do you have any news about my son? And he was fumbling and mumbling, and he said, step aside to see another one running. Those boys could run. They would run miles. They would outrun a horse. The best horse could only run 8 miles and would faint. The best horse. These men ran about 26 miles, 28 miles, and didn't stop. Oh, what a machine man is. God made you beautiful. And he came, he bowed down before him and said, oh, king. King said, what's the news? He said, those who hated you are killed. Meaning that Absalom died. A horrible death. Riding on his mule, he came through a cluster of oak trees, and in a V shape, his neck got trapped in the V, and his hair, he had glorious hair. He would cut his hair once a year, and he would shed 40 pounds of hair, long flowing hair. The glory killed him. His pride trapped him. The thing he boasted about brought his downfall, or his high up. Lingering between heaven and earth, trapped, floating in his hair. Abner came and threw three spears into his heart, killed him. And so David wanted to know, what's the fate of his son? So your son is dead. Bad news. Sad news at the gate. Sometimes you sit waiting to hear from the doctor, and you get bad news. You have a relative somewhere in another part of the world, and you're waiting, and you get bad news. You're waiting on your banker. You get bad news. You're waiting on your child's report, and you get bad news. I'd like to just throw a piece of humor here. Break the tension. Daddy, it's Thursday, took his 10-year-old boy and started to whip his behind. Wham, wham. Mother said, why are you beating the kid? He said, well, I'll be out of town tomorrow and he'll be getting his grades. Nobody's going to get, so. Bad news. May I encourage you that sometimes you will have to face bad news. How do you deal with it? You look at it, David pulled aside, covered his face with his hands, and began to weep. It's okay to cry when you have bad news. Christian, don't be deceived with this high puff-up positive mentality confession thing. Everything is going to be all right. I know in the long run, everything is going to be all right. But in the short term, when you stand at the royal gate, sometimes you may have bad news. But you've got to know beyond the bad news, there is good news. The Lord of glory is watching over you. And some of you might get bad news this week, and you may have to face it. Go ahead and cry. But the Lord who loves you and the Lord who cares about you is going to see you through. So there's enemy at the gates and there's bad news at the gates. Let me come to the gate beautiful and talk a little bit about that. So life has left you broken. Life has left you damaged. Life has left crooked things in your pathway. And you were helplessly carried. No fault of yours. You don't have a desire to serve God, and people have to beg you to serve God. You will regret that one day. You will regret the way you treat God now. Because if God treated you the way you treat him, you'll be a sad spectacle. If God is the God who loves you and the God of creation who created you and the God of salvation who justified you, I think he deserves every ounce of our gratitude and our commitment to him. Can I hear an amen? So Peter and John walking up. You might like this. You had to catch it, though. It's a Jamaican one. He's going up, they're going up to the temple, and this man reached out his hand and asked for an arm. And as I just told you, he, instead of getting an arm, he got a leg. Hallelujah. Peter says, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I'm going to give you. You can only give what you have. Don't fool yourself. You can't fabricate things. This brother, this Rasta brother, wanted to give something to his pastor for pastor's appreciation. But the guy didn't have any money, didn't have any cash. But he had a whole bag of marijuana. But he realized he can't give the pastor or this pastor the bag of marijuana, or some of it. So he decided to convert it. So he went to the bank. He took the bag of marijuana, was all folded up, nice little What's the word? And he put the bag on the counter. And the teller opened it and saw these marijuana sticks. She said, "What's this?" He said, "Ma'am, I am here to open a joint account." "And I want you to open it for me and me pastor." "Such as I have, give I unto thee." But Peter didn't even have anything else. He was told not to carry a purse. But he had something far greater than what money can buy. And looking at the man who's expecting something material, he said, "Such as I have, give I thee in the name." Say, "In the name." In that name, all your brokenness will be straightened out. In that name, all your poverty will change to wealth. In that name, you will no longer remain the same. You will no longer be the person that is being carried. From this moment on, your life will change. Your tomorrow will never be like your yesterday. Your today is going to be excessively great and abundantly allowed by God to rejoice. The spirit of joy is coming upon you today because it's in that name. In the name of Jesus. Rise up and walk. Sometimes people need a little more than prayer. He stretched out his hand, held his hand, and gave him a lift. You know, many times you say, "Brother, I'm praying for you." And when the brother really needed was a $5 bill. Prayer is wonderful and prayer is good. But sometimes you have to do a little more than praying. You got to reach down. You got to give that helping hand. And you got to hold that hand and lift them up. I don't know about you, but sometimes I wish I could have find somebody when I felt down and discouraged to lend a helping hand and say, "Pastor, get up from that sloppy condition you're in. Get out of that depression that you're in. Get out of that mess you're mentally trapped in. Oh, there is power in the name of Jesus, but there is help in the hand that reaches down and lifts you up." Give somebody a hand. Just give somebody a hand there. Go ahead. Give like if you a helping hand. Hallelujah. Now, I want to give you a revelation here. Why do you wait at the gate? And what is the gate and where should you wait for God to make things straight? And I'm going to be straight with you. Because you may not like what I'm going to say. It's all right. Genesis 28:17. Jacob was running from his father's, from his brother's anger. And somewhere south of Jerusalem, north of Jerusalem, yes, 5 miles north of Jerusalem, night took him and he fell asleep, the stone for his pillow. In that sleep, he had a dream, a vision. He saw a ladder ascending to heaven. Angels trafficking up and down. And when he got up, this is what he said. And he was afraid and said, "How awesome is this place?" I want you to hear carefully. I want this revelation to meet you. The place of revelation. The place of ladder
and the place of angels ascending and going up to heaven and coming and touching earth. He said, this place is none other than the house of God. And this is the gate of heaven. He brought a truth that would echo throughout Scripture, that the house of God is the gate to heaven. I am going to tell you, you can meet God anywhere under a tree in the open fields, but God has established his house for a purpose, that his house is the gate to heaven. And if you want to go to heaven, I am not saying a church will take you there, but a church will help you to get there. A church is like the gate. It is not heaven, but it will open up the vista of heaven to you. You've got to come to church. You've got to come to church. You've got to come to church. Are you hearing me? Because the church, the house of the Lord, is the gate to heaven. And it's a beautiful gate. It is when you wait at this gate, God will make everything straight. You can't come to church once a year and expect God to be on your side. Forget it. Stop the foolish thinking. You've got to honor the house of the Lord. You've got to respect what God said. This place of revelation is not other but the house of God. And this house of God is the gate of heaven. Give me Jeremiah 7:2 if you can. Therefore, stand in the gate of the Lord's house, he's saying that to me, and proclaim there this word and say, hear the word of the Lord, all of you Judah who enter in at these gates to worship the Lord. When you come through those doors, you are coming through the gate. Enter his gate with thanksgiving in your heart. You come in the house of the Lord through the gates of glory to worship the Lord. This house is the gate. And when you wait at this gate, God will make everything straight. I beg of you, as a father, you know, this year I'm serving the Lord 49 years. I'm studying this Bible for 50 years professionally. I bring to you my heart, and I didn't want to follow an outline today. I say, God, you just talk to your people. And God is saying, you know, it's wonderful for you to have family fellowship at home. That's beautiful. It's a great thing. But the spirit of the home might not be the spirit of the church. And that's why you see the kind of worship we had this morning. You see the kind of environment that you find yourself in. That's the environment you need. And the Lord just say, give you this illustration. Listen to me carefully. What's the difference between your house, a good prayer meeting in your house, a wonderful sing time, worship time in your house, and the church? What's the difference? Is there a difference? Well, let me illustrate it to you. Why church is important and why coming to the house of God is extremely crucial, because it's a gate. Remember, you got to wait at this gate. And then God will make everything straight. Your marriage will straighten out. Your wicked, rebellious children will suddenly get good and straighten out. Not by magic, but by the power of the living God. Because you're learning to wait. So, but you can't wait. So you say, you know, coming to church, you go somewhere else and wait by the park. It's better to go by the beach and wait and watch the sunrise or the sunset. Ah, wasting your time. Those things are good for people who have nothing better to do. My encouragement to you is to wait in the house of the Lord. Amen. Don't wait till you get old like Anna, 84 years old. She waited in the temple day and night. Start doing that while you're young and see what a bright future you've got. Let me show you the difference, and I'm closing with this, between your house anywhere else and the house of God. Women, help me. You're going to bake a cake. You know how good I am at baking, okay? So you whip up all the ingredients. You follow the recipe to the T, and you have a perfect cake mixed. So here is the oven. Here is the cake mix. They're sitting side by side. Will that do the cake any good?
No.
How do you mean? It's near the oven. Okay. Wise lady said, we've got to open the oven, take the mixture, and put it in the oven. That is that all. My wife kind of argued with me yesterday because she had to go out and she wanted to put something in the oven and tell me, could you put the oven? No, watch the oven. Could you turn the oven on? I said, honey, I don't know anything about the oven. And she was getting furious. You mean you can't hit this button that says on? I said, I don't want to mess up your stuff. Oh, so she forgave me and went away. But I noticed she did something before that. She hit a preheat button. You see, worship is like the preheat button. It heats things up. So that when the turkey comes, not me, the word, the meat. When the meat comes, the environment is hot and ready. Not until you put the meat in a preheated oven and set the temperature will any good come to your fantastic recipe. That's the difference between near the oven and in the oven. You could come near church, you could pass by, you could drive, you could come and say hello and leave. You've got to stay the course of the 2 hours that we have service here. That's why church is important, because the heat you get here, you won't get anywhere else. I beg you, I encourage you, I humble myself before you as your pastor, your shepherd, whatever title you give me, and I beg you to come to church as God opens a Sunday morning. Give God 2 hours out of the 168 hours that he's given you. Is it wrong to give God 2 hours? Be reasonable. Find time. Make time. Start preparing on a Saturday evening to come to church on a Sunday morning. Don't wait till 10 o'clock in the morning looking for your shoes and your socks and you can't find this. I keep Saturday evening reserved for the Lord. I don't go anywhere. I make sure everything is set and everything is right and my spirit is right and my prayer is right and the blood of Jesus is over me and I watch for Sunday morning because it's holy unto the Lord. It's the Lord's hour. It's the Lord's day and I want to be in the house of God. As for me and my house, stop fooling around. Wait at the gate, for here he'll make everything straight, or else your life will continue in its crooked course until you end up in hell. I am not saying church will save you, but I'm saying church will help you. I'm not saying it's a kingdom. I'm saying it's a gate. And when you wait at the gate, something beautiful is going to happen to you. Can you say amen?